the cases of alteration in documents. You see, figure 1 has been added with a different thing. The lower portion is a processed image in VSE 2000. And you see the fluorescence of the ink is different. You see the figure 1 and see figure 5. The ink differs. Not only the ink, but the relative alignment and placing of figure 1 also differs widely. So I think there's no doubt to say that figure 1 was added subsequently. Then here another case of addition or addition in a document or insertion in a earlier existing document. So the portion consenting to the agreed, this one portion, this was added to the original document. So, but there was a line which was existing already. You see the vertical stroke of the letter G was crossing this line. So then the order of intersection of stroke became very important for us. And when we process this document in our documents, in our systems, we found that the letter G, the vertical stroke of letter G was found subsequently written over the existing mark, which helped us to conclude that yes, this portion was inserted on the document. Then this is the large view of the same thing. You see the continuity of stroke of letter G. It is crossing. It means it was written subsequently over the existing horizontal line. Then another case of alteration in document. You see figure 1 was added. Originally the check was for 15,000 rupees only. And this figure 1 was added. And here in words also, the writing has been added on the check. So this is the processed image. You see the fluorescence of figure 1 here and rest of the figures. It differs. Then likewise, the next slide of the same case. So then some cases in which the signature is genuine, yet the document is forged, which we now call as built up documents. So you see, actually, this signature had some space over it, which was exploited by the forger. You see here the cut marks here, earlier. The case was, you see the document was torn from some genuine document and the body writing of the receipt written over it. So never leave a space blank over your signature in future. So then altered writings. You see how clear it is seen here. It is not so when we actually see the actual document. It is a processed image. You see, figure 9 was converted into figure 8 here. Then another case of built-up document. You see, figure 5, this was erased by the person. When we examined it in ultraviolet light, so this figure 5 was also brought up. There was a chemical eraser because it was becoming a hurdle for the accused to use this existing signature. Then another thing, signature on a blank sheet. Never give a signature on a blank sheet. Although it is legally valid to give a signature on the blank sheet, but still there may be fraud or forgery over it. Then another case of eraser. Here in passports, the sex was changed. M was changed to F. You see, an interesting thing, I had a friend of mine who is a passport officer in Shimla. He told me the other day that a lady came to me and said that, "You have changed my sex." I was surprised. Then she told me that my sex has been changed in the passport. So you rechange it. Anyway. Then the same case. And another case, figure 0 was added. Actually, the check was drawn for 227 rupees and figure 0 was added. And here, the word 100 was changed to read as 1000. Then, this slide has been prepared to show that the typewriting was done when the revenue stamp was existing on the paper. Because you see, portion of the letter S is appearing on the revenue stamp. Had it been otherwise, the portion of the letter S should have been below the rubber stamp. Then another case of addition in typed documents. You see, the check was, you see, the document was early, meant for rupees 9,000 only, and it was converted into 30,09,000. You see, so many. This entry was added here, 15 lakh, and then this 15 lakh and zero here, it was added, here it was added. And of course, with a different typewriter. Then the infamous Sister Abhaya case, tampering was done on medical legal report. So you see the portions. The doctor is saying that semen were found negative. Semen were found negative. No signs. And so on and so forth. But actually when we examined it in different light arrangements, we could find that there are traces of earlier writing which could have been read as positive. The letter traces of letter P were visible and part letter final E were visible. The positive word was converted into negative. Here, you see, not word, not detected. Actually, it was detected, and the word not was added subsequently to change the basic nature of the report. You see, this word not, it has been subsequently added. The same case. This is a unique case of alteration which was examined in our Shimla lab. You see, the nomination papers of a candidate for assembly elections, these were actually accepted by the returning officer. But subsequently, he came to know that these papers should have been rejected. So he changed the his own endorsement with a different ink. You see here, the top portion is the original entry as is seen from the document. And here, when we examined it in VSC 2000, we find this letter A of Hindi added. The word Vaid, meaning valid, was changed to read as Avaid, meaning invalid. And a further line was added, Abhyarthi Dwara Form A and B, 23-1-2002 ko 4-10. Again, the forger leaves some trail. AM, he wrote by mistake AM, whereas it should have been PM. That is a genuine alteration. In fact, that is a genuine alteration. That is not a fraudulent one. But the entire entry is now suspicious. Then the another entry on another document in the same case, likewise. Then you see figure 1 added and the writing 1000 added with a different ink. Involving, this has a ramification of crores of rupees in a famous golden quadrilateral project of Government of India. Then not only handwriting and typewriting and other things are examined by us. So in a case I had examined and reported upon the staple pin marks. Staple pins actually, not staple pin marks. I have compared the staple pins in a progress report of a child which needed such comparison to say that the upper pins differ from the lower pins. I actually photographed them at a magnification of 50 times in proscope and found the differences on the basis of physical measurement of pins and the rust deposition patterns here. You see the rust is depositing here, but which is not found here like this. So I also gave the opinion that these two pins were different. Then typewriting identification. These are some of the features of typewriting. Then damaged typefaces. These come to the rescue of examiner. You see, brand new typefaces cannot be exploited by the expert to say, to prove or disprove the origin of the typewriting. So, but when the typewriters, typefaces get worn and torn, then it definitely helps more opportunities. Then same, the vertical twist in the letters. Normally, all the characters are perpendicular. So by the twisting of the letters, twisting of the typefaces, the angle of the vertical strokes were changed. And likewise. And another case of alteration in typewriting. This 20,000 were, the 20 lakhs were added here. And the amount was changed. Actually, the amount was for 11,000 only. And 40 lakh has been added. And this earlier slide, earlier. Now this is also a case of insertion of typewriting. You see, this portion has been inserted on it, with a fraudulent motive with a different typewriter. So here, friends, in cases of typewriting, we can definitely say whether the origin is common or not. But in a rarest of the rare cases, we can also fix the typing habits of a person. On comparison, the typing habits of the person, we can say that yes, such and such typed it. So this is a important case. This was a important evidence in a murder case in Shimla, where on the basis of letter simple full stop, after putting the figures of date, the IO informally brought the documents to me in the lab, and I saw the habit of putting a dot after the figures of date. So on the basis of that, I asked the IO to procure more material, and when the more material came, I was able to fix the identity of the typist. So then writing on a charred document. Friends, recovered from the scene of crime, a charred document is also of value. Sometimes it may be difficult to carry and send it to laboratory after packing, and on the scene of crime itself, we can decipher what was written on the document with the help of infrafill lamp. Simple infrafill lamp has been used to decipher the writings. So friends, thank you very much. I hope I have not enjoyed any
existing enclaves with their attendant theorist rest is likely to fall back to mere notional assent. To sustain them, however, assent must rather be real. It must engage not merely the cognitive but the emotive life. Hence, enclaves of justice which men hold must even tenaciously defended, extended, and revitalized. We again stress that, and insofar as these enclaves of justice are concerned, legislators, judges, and administrators cannot suspend such decisions pending full classification and consensus about justice, which would in effect be sine die. But they and we must at least do what we can to subject their decisions to reasoned examination. Towards this inescapable need, the studies. In the meantime, the challenges thus thrown up, men can move forward only from where they stand, and it is correspondingly vital that they should note with care and understanding where this is and they came to it. For human justice, these wider truths bear down with great force, especially when justice must first be recalled to men before they can remember and recognize it. A society in which the questionings of justice cease to be a constant prod and perplexity would not be human in any sense that matters. As a matter of fact, it is this very important continuity of understanding the theories of justice, questioning them, maintaining the continuity, evolve new theories of justice that is necessary. And hence, in such a seminar where administration of justice is examined from the perspective of forensic science, what is very inevitable is to find out new methods, evolve new theories, so that the changing society can meet the ends of justice. From this point of view, the present session relating to question documents has been a very important session, because with changing times, modernization, the criminals have been evolving newer and newer methods, and investigators will have to cope up to trace, investigate, and check these newer and newer methods. As a matter of fact, criminals are faster than the investigating officers in inventing the methods of crime. And until the investigating officers cope up with that speed, they will not be able to do justice. And in this context, this particular session has been a very important session, and the two institutions which have been holding this national seminar on forensic science in the administration of justice would be a very useful contribution in the development of the theories of justice. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Profile. I welcome you, sir. And now introduce Dr. B. M. Mohan. He has completed MSc and has also a PhD. He has a total of 33 years of experience, which include teaching and research as well. He has, to his credit, about 36 papers published in national and international journals. He has authored two books on forensic science. He is the first Indian forensic scientist to get an American Award of Diplomat of American Board of Forensic Examiner. To his credit is the National Award for Excellence in Forensic Science. Presently, he is the director of Karnataka State Forensic Science Laboratories, Bangalore. I welcome you, sir. Thirdly, let me introduce Dr. Malini. She is a person of high profile with MSc, MPhil, PhD, Diploma in Experimental Hypnosis, Diploma in Electrophysiology and Neuropsychology. She is a guest faculty of National Police Academy, Hyderabad and Karnataka Judicial Academy. She has contributed many articles published in national and various international journals. Presently, she is the Assistant Director of Forensic Psychology Division in Karnataka State Forensic Science Laboratory, Bangalore. I welcome you, madam. This is the brief introduction. I request the chairman to present a bouquet and a memento to Dr. Thank you, sir.
Distinguished experts on the dais, the director of Forensic Science Lab, and a distinguished forensic scientist, Dr. Mohan, assistant director of Forensic Science Lab, and a renowned expert in the field of brain mapping and narcoanalysis, and Dr. Malini. Distinguished members in the audience. In the course of the concluding remark, the chairman of the first session was emphasizing on the fact that the criminals find innovative methods for avoiding being detected, and the investigating team may have to be much more smarter than the criminals. Over a period of time, we have noticed that several new scientific techniques have evolved for detection of the crime. Several new techniques have evolved for eliciting the truth, eliciting the facts. And one such important development is in the field of narcoanalysis and the brain mapping technology. The Bangalore Forensic Science Lab should be appreciated for all the great work that it has been doing in assisting the not only the investigative team, but also the country in knowing in advance as to what kind of criminal activities are likely to crop up and how that could be effectively plugged or prevented. And in this process, the narcoanalysis and brain mapping have helped. Though as a scientific technique, they have been evolved, several legal issues have cropped up time and again. It starts directly from the admissibility of the information collected in the process of conducting narcoanalysis and the brain mapping. Does this get affected by the rights conferred on a citizen under Article 23 of the Indian Constitution? Does it invade the privacy rights under Article 21 of the Indian Constitution? Is that curtailed by 161 of the Criminal Procedure Code, 26 and 25 of the Evidence Act, or could that be accommodated in Section 27 of the Indian Evidence Act? How does the fruits of the poisonous tree apply? Whether evidence collected through a method which has not obtained the legal sanction, which has not been approved, which does not comply with the due process, whether such evidence would still be admissible or not, or do we go by the fruits of the poisonous tree theory? And ultimately, how? Ultimately, it could be accommodated as an expert evidence. These are some of the legal issues that would crop up perhaps towards the end of the seminar in case there are any issues left undiscussed. I would touch upon that. But before that, I would request the expert speakers to start with Dr. Mohan, Forensic Science Laboratory Director. I request Dr. Mohan to speak on the narcoanalysis and its effects.
This opportunity of sharing whatever we have done and how it could be put onto the future pedals. Let me at the very outset again thank my friend Professor Ramakrishna, who's chairing the session. And he's the one who has been associating with us right from the inception of both the brain mapping as well as narcoanalysis technologies. Now, since the title is about the forensic science in administration of justice, perspectives, challenges, I thought of making a small presentation before I really move on to narcoanalysis. What are the technologies currently available for determiners of truth?